Welcome back. In this module, we're going to be taking a look at roles and permissions. And this is a key one for administrators because this is where you decide exactly how your users are going to be interacting with NetSuite. So let's take a look at this. All right, here we are in the home dashboard. So to be able to manage roles, we go up to Setup. We're going to go down to Users Roles, and you'll see over here Manage Roles. So we're going to click on that. And it basically gives us this long list of all the roles in this NetSuite instance. So we can see, notice here we've got standard roles, and you'll see custom roles intermixed with standard. So it's key to understand there's standard roles. You could really think of those almost like templates for roles that come with NetSuite. So you have like a controller, a sales rep, all of these common roles, you'll have these standard templates for them. And what you're going to be doing is you're going to take those standard roles and you're going to make a copy of them, which is a custom role, and you'll make little tweaks and modifications to that standard role to then have your custom role. And when you do that, I'll give you an example here. A common practice is to rename it. In this case, this one has FinMM dash and then the role name. So this is a custom role, and you'll have, let's say it's ABC Company, you can have ABC dash and then the role name to specify that this is, you're no longer dealing with a standard role, but you're now dealing with your custom role. And a good way to think about this is that you're not trying to go in, create a bunch of new roles or craft a role from scratch. You're really gonna start with all of these standard existing roles. You're gonna swap them over to be custom roles, and then you can make modifications and changes to those as you go. But you really wanna take these standard roles as a baseline. And it is also common practice during the implementation process to basically make a copy of all of those standard roles, especially the ones that apply to your company. And then as time goes on, you'll be passing out and basically granting access to those roles. So we're gonna be taking a look at how to do that in this video. Specifically, I wanna point out, notice here, when you have a standard role, you'll have the ability to customize it. But when you see edit, that's a custom role that's already been made. And now we can go in there and we can make further modifications to that custom role. So let's take a simple one here. We see the sales representative down here. Let's go over to edit on sales representative. All right, so we have the page here. And the first thing you'll see obviously is the name at the top. So you'll see it's the sales representative and that it is a custom sales representative role. And I'm gonna be basically walking you through item by item what all these things do. So the first thing we can see, just taken from the top, is center type. So we've obviously talked about centers already, so you understand a concept of that. Center is something that you don't have the option to modify what the center is. It is gonna be locked in depending on the role. So for a sales rep, you're gonna get the sales center for that role. So that just notes down what it is there. Do keep in mind though that if that sales rep, let's say employee Joe, who is a sales rep, wants to change their center, they do have the ability in set preferences to have it go back to the classic center. So that is always an option. Down from that, we have employee restrictions. So here, if I drop this down, you'll see we have four types of restrictions. And I'll just break it down piece by piece. So again, if we're talking about Joe, the sales rep, the first restriction is own and subordinate only. And own refers to that role and that person, that employee, Joe. So own and subordinate only means, let's say if he's looking at customer records, he is only gonna be able to access, and the records he's gonna deal with are restricted to ones that are related to him. So customers that are related to him as the sales representative, as well as any person who's subordinate to him. So if he has a subordinate and they have customers, he can see those as well and interact with those. The second type is subordinate, owned, subordinate, and unassigned. So now if, let's say there's a bunch of leads that have not been assigned to specific sales reps, he can also access those records. Up from that, we have basically no restriction. And there's two versions of that. There's none, no default, which just means there's no restrictions, nothing's previously set. Everything's just as it would normally be. And then none default to own. That means that let's say Joe starts a sales order. As soon as he does that, he's now he has no restrictions, but as soon as he creates something like a sales order, it's gonna default to his information. So it's gonna put in you know, his name, it's going to have his subsidiary, his location. That information is going to fill in certain fields. So in certain instances, especially transactions, it's just going to automatically default to the things related, not just to that role, but also to that employee. So those are the four: the own and subordinates only, the own subordinate and unassigned, and then the two nones. Now, one key thing to point out, obviously the none, that means there's no restrictions, but let's say we do own and subordinates only. Suddenly we have this option here, which is allow viewing. And if we click on that, it means that his restrictions are just to his and his subordinates' records, but he does have the ability to view other records. So there is that caveat. Now, you can't necessarily edit or, you know, do alterations with those records, but he does have the ability to view them. So that's something that can be selected. Now, going to the top right here, just take this one by one. Do not restrict employee fields. So that's specifying that if there's any kind of a drop-down menu or list or a field where this person is selecting an employee, so let's say Joe is creating a sales order or a lead maybe, and there's a field where he can select from employees, he's gonna have, it's not gonna have a restriction. So he's not gonna be restricted just certain employees. He's gonna be able to choose any employee. It's going to give him all of the options there. So that field, by clicking do not restrict, it gives him that ability to choose any employee for any field that has employees as part of it. Next down, we have restrict time and expenses. So that's basically going to limit this employee to only be able to see time, like, you know, if employees logging time or expenses related to an employee, ones that are just in that person's purview. So only records that employee, especially related to them, would be able to monitor. So if it's the sales representative, he's only going to be able to see time and expenses for him and for his subordinate. So again, it's restricting it in that regard. The next three that we see here, sales role, support, and partner. So let's just take sales role. They're all in the same kind of vein. Sales role, and you'll see that it's checked because obviously he's in a sales role. The purpose of that is to make it so that, let's say you have teams of sales reps. You don't necessarily want one sales rep to be able to look at all the customer information for a different sales rep, especially if there's commissions and, you know, you definitely want them to be able to have their own leads and customers. So, or, you know, estimates, commissions, things like that. So by selecting that, it is going to be limiting that information just to that person. So you select, you know, that person's maybe a sales manager or a sales rep and is in a sales role. You can select that and it gives that limitation to what they can view and edit. So it's the same thing for support roles. If you have an employee who's handling support cases, you don't necessarily want them to be able to access and look at other people's support cases. So if you select that, it will limit it in that regard. And then again, for partners, if you maybe have partners that are resellers, you want, if they have an access point into NetSuite, you want them to only be able to see the things that are relevant, the records that are relevant to them, not just any record in your NetSuite instance. So selecting that will limit it. Then we have inactive. Inactive simply means you have a role that is no longer used. Maybe you have no need for it, or maybe it was a custom role that you now have a different custom role and you're no longer using that first one. You can select that as inactive and it won't be included in lists. Next, we have core administration permissions. So this is a key one. This is something that NetSuite came out with in 2019, and it's not a permanent feature. It's kind of a bit of a stopgap or a temporary access that was given, and the purpose of it is, in certain instances, you might have an employee maybe who needs to have a lot of access into records, but at the same time, they're not an administrator and you don't want to give them an administrator role. So how do you give them some far-reaching access without giving them an administrator role? You can select core administration permissions, and it gives them all of these, I wouldn't say features, but gives them options and various access into records that they wouldn't normally have. And to know exactly what those permissions would be, there is, if you go into Suite Answers, there's an article that covers exactly what those permissions are. And if you look at the Suite Answers ID 82465, it lays it all out so you can list, okay, good. If I give this person, he'll have this exact permissions. So you can take a look at that. And if it's relevant, you can select that feature. So moving down, we have this whole section on subsidiary restrictions. Now, if you remember back to classifications, and there's classifications also referred to as segments. You remember we have classes, departments, locations, and subsidiaries. Those are the four types of classifications. So the three of them, you'll see, I'll get into them in another video, you'll see them below, but subsidiary specifically is brought up into this header section because it's so important from a permission and restriction standpoint. Obviously, if you have a company where, let's say, an employee is in the Detroit subsidiary of a company, all the restrictions that you're applying to him, that's obviously, you don't want him, let's say he can see things by department, you don't necessarily want him to be able to see things in a department for a completely different subsidiary in Miami. You want to limit him just to, I mean, not necessarily in every case, but in most cases, you want to limit him to just that subsidiary. So they put it up here, and as you can see here, obviously, if it's an employee who does is in the parent company or is in kind of the headquarters, you might want them to be able to access all subsidiaries. So you can select all. You could select not just all the subsidiaries, but only the ones. If there's an inactive subsidiary, those won't be included. He won't be able to view those. So you could select active, and that's what that would do. Then you can limit it to just the subsidiary that he's in. So that's pretty common. And you can also do selected, and it pulls up this window here. And that's basically where you're exactly specifying what subsidiaries. So maybe they work in the Australian subsidiary, but you also want them to take a look at the Canada records. So you can select those two, and that would be the access they have. And then lastly, over here in the allow cross-subsidiary record viewing, that's specifying that even though they only have access to certain records in their subsidiary, let's say you specify it to just theirs, they can still view records in another subsidiary. They just can't edit or create or delete them. So then moving down from there, we have authentication. We're gonna look over here first. So we can add two-factor authentication to this role. And so administrators, that's default. You have to have two-factor authentication. But other roles, it depends on your company policy, whether you want to specify that they have 2FA or not. And so you can simply select that here. You can also select the duration that it's going to be a trusted, let's say they log in with their computer with two-factor authentication. How long do they have that access before they have to do another 2FA? So is it just that session? Do you want to specify it? They can use that for a month. You can clarify that as needed. On the left here, we have three specific, now these have very specific use cases, so I'm actually not gonna describe them. It's something you can take a look at. If it's something that you feel is relevant for your company, you can research that and select it as needed, but they can get a little complicated, so I'm not gonna get into these per se. The last thing I do wanna cover though in this video is notice, so at the bottom here, we have now this blue bar. In the space in between, we don't have any additional options, but depending on the NetSuite edition you have, you might have a number of different additional checkboxes down there. You just have to take a look at those, look at the field help. You can also search them in Suite Answers and see if they're relevant for your company and just take it on a case-by-case basis. And that's it for your overview on roles and permissions. In the next video, I'm going to be getting into a deep dive on permissions and restrictions. So I'll see you there.